And my dear students, on the auspicious occasion of first public health symposium hosted by our elite institution, ZEBIS Karachi. We are extremely grateful to our esteemed guest speakers for sparing your valuable time and being part of the symposium. We are honored to have you all with us. I'm Dr. Nida Shoaib, Program Manager, Faculty Public Health, overwhelmed to get this opportunity, address you all as Master of Ceremony. I would like to seek your cooperation and request to kindly switch your mobiles to silent mode, avoid disturbance. Without any further delay, I would like to start with today's event. The proceedings will commence with the recitation of few verses from the glorious Quran.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أعطيناك الكوثر فصل لربك وانحر إن شانئك هو الأبتر
اے نبی صلی اللہ علیہ وآلہ وسلم ہم نے تم کو کوثر یعنی بہت زیادہ بھلائی عطا فرمائی ہے تو اپنے پروردگار کے لیے نماز پڑھا کرو اور قربانی کیا کرو کچھ شک نہیں کہ تمہارا دشمن ہی بے نام رہے گا
سبسکرائب کیجئے ہمارے چینل اور دبائیے بیل کا آئیکن تاکہ آپ کو ریگولر نوٹیفیکیشن اپڈیٹس مل سکے
Honorable guests, attendees and students, ZEBIS has always been proactive and innovative in enhancing the knowledge and skills of our students. It is eminent from the theme of Symposium Health Systems Performance and Lesson Learned 2022 Floods. This event will not only create academic linkages with industry, but will also provide new opportunities, bridge the gap of challenges, and shine the future of our students from the best in the field and experts in their subjects. On that note, let me introduce the head of the department, Dr. Samira Ali Rizvi. She's a public health expert, epidemiologist, researcher. She carries 19 years experience of teaching with multiple consultancies and 15 publications. Ma'am, kindly enlighten our students and audience with the overview of public health department and welcome our prestigious guests and students.
Thank you, Dr. Nida Shoaib, for your kind words. Assalamu alaikum. Good morning, and a very warm welcome to all of you. I would like to welcome all my esteemed and respectable speakers, dear faculty members, and my dear students to the first Public Health Symposium 2023. I would like to take a few minutes to introduce the Department of Public Health. ZEBIS is a highly ranked and fully chartered institute in Pakistan. Department of Public Health, under the umbrella of Faculty of Life Sciences, is progressing currently two fully recognized HSC programs, Masters of Science in Public Health and Bachelors of Science in Public Health. So we have students from both the programs here. Here at ZEBIS, at the Department of Public Health, we envision preparing public health leaders who are engaged in academia and research. We aim to empower our students with the knowledge and skills in creating innovative solutions for health problems. At the same time, our faculty members are engaged in cross-cutting research to address the current and relevant public health issues. Today we have joined for the first public health symposium titled Health System Performance and Lessons Learned from the Recent Floods 2022. It is the need of the day indeed. We all understand the importance of meeting the criteria and the expectations of the government, and we have to come up with the expectations of the policymakers as well. Department of Public Health is organizing this symposium just to enlighten our students with the respective knowledge of our esteemed speakers. They all are coming from a diverse background, with ample experiences, their current experiences and their past experiences. I hope you will be enlightened and you will always remember this symposium as one of the learning experience in your careers while you are a student at Zabist. Department of Public Health would like to express our gratitude to President Madam Shehnaz Wazir Ali. She is going to join us shortly. Madam Nasreen Haq, she will also join us shortly. She is the VP Finance. Our Dean, Dr. Muhammad Kashif Ali Sahab, he is sitting here. Thank you, sir, for your kindness. He has always provided his support and guidance to our program. So we look forward to hear from our esteemed speakers. And from this note, I hand over this podium to Dr. Nida Shoaib for the running of this symposium of the day. Welcome to all of you one more time. Thank you.
Thank you, madam, for your kind words and hospitality. We would be delighted to have your suggestions and questions at the end of each presentation. So I would humbly request you to maintain discipline and avoid interrupting the guest speakers during presentation. So we begin our symposium with the well-known professor, Dr. Mehtab Kareem. Dr. Mehtab Kareem is currently affiliated with Department of Public Health at Zabist, and he's a professor emeritus at Aachen University. He has also served as a professor and head of reproductive health program at AKU, School of Public Policy at George Mason University and Johns Hopkins University. He has authored and co-authored 3 books, over 30 research articles on population and health issues in Pakistan and Muslim-majority countries. Sir, you have motivated us all enough by being a true legend in the field of demography and public health. So you're requested to introduce our audience for the theme of the symposium and provide your stance on health systems performance and disruption during floods. Sir, please.
Dean Kashif Ali, our esteemed speakers and dear students, and Dr. Nasreen Haq, our Vice President. We welcome you all to this symposium. I'm not the person who's an expert on floods, but I have some other expertise to which I would like to link the floods with. Pakistan is confronted with many, many disasters. Of course, there are some man-made disasters and there are some natural disasters. Of course, natural disaster is, floods are one of the natural disasters, besides earthquakes and many others. So we are going to hear from our speakers about what are the repercussions, how the floods which occurred in, especially in Sindh during last year, how they have affected the delivery of services, health services, in general, and public health in particular. Let me talk about the man-made disaster. I don't think you guessed it, because there, too, in my opinion, the man-made disaster for Pakistan is the growing population. At the rate of 2.5%, it just came out from the census, and it's still counting. They have so far counted 241 million people in Pakistan, plus about 6 million in Gilgit-Baltistan. So we are approaching, perhaps we have already approached about 250 million. If you listen to our political figures and the media, which is rife with talking about how we are undercounted, some people say that just in the province of Sindh, about 5 million people need to be counted further. And I'm a witness to it because I have been working on the census. And it is happening not only in Sindh, but perhaps all over Pakistan. Why it is so important? If our population were not growing at the rate it is growing, more than twice the growth rate of population in other South Asian countries, and that includes not only India and Bangladesh, but poorer countries like Nepal and Bhutan, where the growth rate has subsided to about 1% per annum. Now, how are we going to cope with a growth rate of 2.5% or say even 2%, which I doubt? The government claims it is 2%. On the one hand, the Pakistan Bureau of Statistics released a figure of 2% growth rate only in 2021, and now they're saying, no, our population is growing much faster. So if we had to, we have to be content with what we have, just imagine that what if we would have fewer population as instead of 240 million as Bangladesh has done, about 165 million people. We have almost approaching about 100 million more than them. And they are the one who are who have floods every year. But I have not read much about the repercussions of those floods on delivery of health services in Bangladesh. Now let me just give you some figures about floods in Pakistan and what sort of devastation it has caused, each of them have caused. For example, in the 2003 floods, about last, I'm just talking about last 20 years. In the 2000 flooding in Sindh, at least 484 people died, about, just say, about 500. That figure jumped to 1,000 in 2010. In 2011, that figure in the 16 districts of Sindh, 5.3 million people were affected by floods. The number of people who died reached 2,000. And the number of, I'm unable to, I couldn't find the figures of the how many people died in the most recent flood. It says that from 5.3 million people affected in Sindh by 2011 floods, the 22 floods, all of us know, resulted in about 33 million people died, more than 2,000. I'm sorry, 33 million people, unfortunately, didn't die. They were affected, and about 2,000 died. So every time there's a flood, the number of casualties has been increasing. So that's what I'm saying, that if we are unable to control this population growth, and this, you know, the this climate change is a reality. We have to live with it. It's not going to stop. The perhaps, as the, I know, most of you must have read it, in, or some of you must have read it in yesterday's newspaper, that our temperature is increasing. Perhaps the next 5 years are going to be the hottest days in Pakistan's history, or many parts of the world, actually. So what do we need to do here? We have to be careful in the how the planning is made. When we are not, we don't know how many people live in this country, or at least regions of the country, how are we going to do planning? That's the, so development planning is one of the, should be one of the top priorities. Of course, I don't have to talk much about it, that all the floods have affected because our lives, because we have experts talking about it. But one issue which is very close to my own research work is that it's not only the casualties, the direct impact, the impact on the mental health of the people, those people who are internally displaced, and we know many, many people have been displaced due to floods, recent floods, and I'm sure that we, when we have our experts talking about it, they are going to tell us that how to deal with such a situation. Dr. Rab is sitting here, and I'm sure he's going to talk about how health services, the delivery of not health services, family planning services have been affected. And what I know, and what the figures are telling us, that starting with COVID and the floods in 2020, 21, and 22, our family planning services have been grossly affected. And that's why the growth rate of population, or you may call directly the fertility rate or birth rate, has not declined. And so where we are, I think one has to take into account where we go from here. And unless until we do that, I think we are going to keep on struggling with both the man-made and the natural disasters. With that, I would like to stop here. I'm sure that we are going to have many, many questions and answers coming from the podium, as well as from the audience. And again, I'd like to welcome you all to the symposium. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir, for the elaboration on today's theme. Dear all, we have a reputable senior technical advisor from Pathfinder, Dr. Zeb Dahar. She's a public health specialist and a medical graduate with master's in sociology and public health. Dr. Zeb has 25 years of experience providing leadership, management, and program development in the field of women, children health, and primary health care, as well as reproductive health and MNCH. She has worked in local and international organizations like UN agencies, UNFPA, UNICEF, JAPIGO, collaborating with government ministries of health services, regulation, coordination, and many medical universities in Sindh. She carries an immense experience in developing national MNCH programs and family program, as well as nutritional program through support of European Union and World Bank. Dr. Zeb has a very unique experience of implementing innovative health financing schemes in public sector through UN program funded by a Norwegian-Pakistan partnership initiative in 10 districts. With this, I would like to invite Dr. Zeb on stage to enlighten us with her knowledge.
Thank you, Dr. Nida. I have a presentation, so. Okay, so thank you very much, and I'm very grateful that I'm being invited here to talk to you. So like Dr. Mehtab Karim said, that man-made disaster is the first most, and the flood disaster is actually aggravated by this man-made disaster. So man-made disaster was, increasing growth rate. So I will talk a little about, you know, what happened to the reproductive health services, what kind of disruptions, health system experienced during these floods. So as you know that most vulnerable group for all the disasters is children and women. ज़्यादातर ख़वातीन और बच्चे जो हैं वो अफेक्ट होते हैं और अगर देखा जाए तो ना सिर्फ MNCH सर्विसेज बल्कि फैमिली प्लानिंग सर्विसेज बहुत कम हो गई. डॉक्टर मेहताब करीम ने बताया कि कोविड में भी यही हुआ था कि जब हम पूरे डेटा को जो सर्विस डिलीवरी डेटा है उसको जब देखते थे तो यही सर्विसेज डिलीवरी सर्विसेज तो कम नहीं हुई थी क्योंकि डिलीवरी इट हैपेंस यू नो एनी टाइम एनी वेयर इवन इफ हेल्थ फैसिलिटीज इज क्लोज डिलीवरी ने होना है लेकिन उसमें ये था कि इंस्टीट्यूशनल डिलीवरीज कम हुई एंड सेम इज हैपेंड इन फ्लड रीसेंट फ्लड डिलीवरीज हुई होंगी लेकिन इंस्टीट्यूशनल डिलीवरीज कम हुई अस्पतालों में कम हुई लेकिन फैमिली प्लानिंग का ग्राफ even in COVID, even in recent flood was gone down. Uska reason ye tha ki we as a nation do not prioritize family planning. Even our management system, although there are lots of efforts, you know, going into the system to improve family planning, but somehow our communities are not yet sensitized enough to, seek aggressively jo health services hoti hain family planning ki. इवन जब हम लोगों की कोऑर्डिनेशन मीटिंग होती थी दैट वाज एट द नेशनल लेवल एज वेल एज एट यू नो प्रोविंशियल लेवल एंड डिस्ट्रिक्ट लेवल तो उसमें ये डिस्कस किया जाता था कि प्रायोरिटी इज द लाइफ सेविंग सो ट्रांसपोर्टेशन ऑफ वुमेन यू नो फ्रॉम देयर IDPs और डिस्प्लेस केम टू द हेल्थ फैसिलिटीज सो दैट वाज द बिग इशू एंड यू नो कम्बेटिंग अदर एलिमेंट्स लाइक डायरिया आउटब्रेक मलेरिया आउटब्रेक So that kind of things. So jab hum khawateen jo ke camps mein hoti thi unse baat ki jati thi, because even those women who were, you know, using contraceptive, they were not, I mean, using it because somehow they have, you know, left their stock. Jo unke paas agar pills use karti hain, injection, whatever, wo gharon mein chhod ke aayi thi. So the system this time, I mean, responding to the disaster was well prepared. Even jo 2010 ke flood se tha, zyada behtar respond kiya. But even then, I mean, as Dr. Mehtab said, that it's, this climate change is now. So it's not going to go anywhere. So we have to live with it. So hame jo hai preparedness is, we have lots of learning from all these disasters. Humne bahut seekha hai aur seekh rahe hai. So at least we can, you know, decrease the gap which we are, you know, experiencing every time in the disaster. So ye fayda hai. I just wanted to show you a couple of, you know, figures which some research work happened after, you know, floods. Ke kaun si services related to reproductive health services ke kya dynamics rahe, what kind of disruptions happened. Aur dusra jo meri aaj main aapko slides dikhaungi usme what lesson actually we learned. हमने इससे लेसन क्या लर्न किया है. सो डिस्टर्प्शन सो आई हैव पुट यू नो सम ऑफ द रेफरेंसेस एज वेल. सो इफ यू कैन सी देयर वर सम स्टडीज इन अफेक्टेड districts and IDPs came. They asked some, you know, question from the displaced woman. Unse pucha gaya. To jo figures batai ja rahi hain. This is one of the study which I found it is was, I mean, one of the robust. That's why I wanted to share with you. So hamare apne experiences to hain, lekin this is overall system. You know what exactly the system experience. इसमें जो बैरियर थे, देर वॉज अ लिमिटेड यूज ऑफ एफपी मेथड. जो हम सिस्टम के थ्रू द कैंप्स विच वर प्रोवाइडिंग फैमिली प्लानिंग सर्विसेज एंड आईडीपी के कैंप्स वर वेरी फ्यू, लाइक कंडोम्स, पिल्स, इंजेक्शन. एंड मोस्ट ऑफ द कैंप्स वर नॉट कैटरिंग द सर्विसेज विच आर लॉन्ग टर्म, लाइक इम्प्लांट्स, आईयूसीडी, बिकॉज ऑफ यू नो अरेंजमेंट. सो that's why the statistics says that most of the women were using 41% combined oral pills, 36% injectables, and 14% had access for emergency contraceptive, and implant was 5%, and IUCD was even lesser than it. So the as I said in coordination meeting, when even we were talking with the, you know, health system managers for these gaps, they said that the priority is life saving, you know, not family planning. But to me, I mean, family planning is a life saving. I mean, WHO says if you just do, you know, family planning, it can decrease maternal mortality up to 1/3, you know, just simply observing family planning. So it's very powerful even in saving lives. So this was the one of the observation, and other was actually commodities, all kind of commodities were unfortunately not available at most of the, I mean, Dr. Rab is going to discuss about logistic of you know, health services and logistic of commodities, so he will tell you in detail. But I mean, the supplies were not, I mean, being carried to the camps where they were needed. And somehow the health system was affected in a way that most of the community level services, like those IDP's camps, were mostly connected through the community level worker with the health facilities. So that was disrupted. For example, LHWs were one of the cadre.
which were assigned some of the medical camps in floods. And unfortunately, most of the LHWs were also affected. Their homes were flooded. So if, you know, persons are not, you know, in their own homes, they are unable to provide healthcare services. So that was another other issue. There was available services in health facilities, and I was talking to Dr. Sara, and there is a study from WHO that around 1,000 health facilities were underwater, were closed, they were locked. So the communities, those were going to those facilities, they didn't have any idea where to go next. I mean, so that kind of services was one of the challenge. And linking that communities which were displaced to, you know, functional facilities was one of the great challenge. And you have heard, you know, stories that some of the women has delivered in boats, in vehicles while transporting from camps to the health facilities. So transport was one of the challenge. I mean, some of the health IDP camps were very well organized. They were equipped with ambulances services 24/7. But I mean, remote camps and smaller camps were has more challenges. Although they were getting, you know, food, shelter, etc. But I mean, health services were not really enough. So yeah, as I discussed, that pregnant women were mostly facing challenges of transportation to health facilities. And the data says, even when the question were asked from women who were displaced and affected in floods, that what they prefer, where they prefer to be delivered, so 44% women says they really want to go to the public health facilities for delivery. So 44% women were going to the pregnant women going to health facilities, and 61% were reported that their younger children is less than 2 years of age. Mean they are not experiencing any family planning. So 61% even those who were displaced were not using any contraceptives. Even they had a baby which was less than 2 years. As I said earlier, that this time health system was very responsive to floods, because most of the learnings we had, I mean, the department both at national, provincial, and district level had a contingency plan. But this time we had a learning, and that was good, but the learning is that those contingency plan were not even translated at the individual health facility level. Health facility staff were not prepared to respond to the emergencies. And not only health facility staff, but also communities. Communities were not prepared. I mean, how to access better health facilities, MNCA services, especially family planning and, you know, delivery care services or neonatal services. So that was the one of the learning from this flood as well. Although this time, after, you know, monsoon warning, most of the government system and functionaries were, they were prepared. They prepared contingency planning, but execution of those contingency planning at the grassroots level was one of the gap in the system. Same service delivery, as I said earlier. Like if 1,000 health facilities were damaged and was flooded with the water and was closed, so at that time there was troubleshooting. I mean, where to move that staff, you know, where to move the health facilities, medicine at that time. So they were not prepared, I mean, because as Dr. Mehtab said, that infrastructure was one of the gap which identified. I mean, some of the facilities were very below the normal, you know, living land. So they were all indented with water. So even those health facilities had no plan how to, arrange for the camps, where staff is going. So it was all troubleshooting. So this time, one of the lessons learned was that those contingency plan, which normally health system develop for provinces and districts, should be at the health facility level as well. And same data information. Although in COVID, there was a very good system in place, you know, reporting on COVID and, you know, analysis. And based on this analysis, you know, vaccination was scheduled. But this time, there was a system in place. The health system, we call it DEWS, Disease Early Warning Signs Alarm. So that is there. But there is a gap or disruption in the capacity when to report on. Although we had so many identification from so many outbreaks, diarrhea outbreaks, malaria outbreaks, but I mean it was at the time when most of the lives were, you know, we lost the lives, and that was not really very timely. Workforce, as I said, you know, even community level workforce like LHWs, their houses were flooded with the water, they were displaced as well. So services as a whole, not only those, but health facilities, those were flooded with the water, those healthcare provider was unable to come to the health facility, and there was a plan B for those healthcare provider, but as in COVID, the health system has a provision to hire on urgent basis, you know, some of the staff who can respond to the emergencies. So that kind of HR is immediately required, which normally UN agencies provide. They establish, you know, on urgent basis, they call it hubs. Maybe Dr. Sara can talk more about it. They establish, you know, the hubs for response to emergencies. So that kind of a part of a health system, although UN has a good support most of the time in all the disasters, it should be part of the health system, which is not yet incorporated. So maybe we need to work with the government and health system structure and management to institutionalize those emergency coordination mechanism to strengthen the system for better response. So these were very few lessons learned, but very important lessons. Inclusion of local partners, as I said, although there was lots of coordination mechanism developed by UNHCR, WHO, they call it 5W matrix, where they, you know, map who is doing what and where. But somehow the local organization, the CBOs who are working with the communities, they are missed out. These coordination meeting mostly happen at the provincial level, and mostly national, recognized national and international organization attend and take part. But the local CBOs, which are actual actor at the time of emergencies and disaster, were not taken into account. So, I mean, it should be inclusive. Whenever there is a broader coordination mechanism for response should be inclusive, and returnees and women needs should be integrated in the response. Like every time when they procure medicine, they just order for all the essential medicine listed down in the essential drug list, instead of, you know, focusing more on the women and children. Sometimes life-saving medicine will be missing. Like, I mean, one of the life-saving, we call it life-saving in MNCH, is called oxytocin injection. That is for prevention of postpartum hemorrhage and misoprostol. Those were not procured. And I call, you know, family planning is also a life-saving medicine. So the system need to cater, women need as a whole. That was missing. Capacity building, I said earlier that responding to the floods and emergencies, mostly UN organizations, you know, establish the district-based, affected district-based hub to respond to the emergencies instead of, although there is a well-defined health system structure available, they call it DDMA, District Disaster Management Authority, PDMA, NDMA, etc. But I mean, the coordination at that level is not as it should be. Like, I mean, we see very obvious coordination supported by UN organization, UNOCHA, WHO, UNICEF for nutrition. UNICEF mostly, you know, work for nutrition, WHO for five W metrics, who is working where and what. But, and UNOCHA for the shelter and livelihood. So that capacity still need to be strengthened into the health system. Coordination again, I mean, as I said earlier, coordination is somehow, is not, because there are lots of players who really wanted to support the affectees in emergencies, even from abroad or in local organization, charitable organization. But the efforts are not really very coordinated. Some get, you know, and mostly the urban flooding. This time, one of the lesson was that the, in urban flooding, most of the support was going into the areas which were nearby and which were urban, accessible, instead of the area going to the area which were more inaccessible and remote. Efficient use of funds, preparedness, again, preparedness. I said, although this time health system was very responsive and prepared for the response to emergencies, but even then, some of the component were missing and need to be strengthened, especially while planning for camps, how many camps to need to organize, how many IUCD kits are required, how many commodities would be required. That kind of quantification is still missing for the preparedness. Again, targeting assistance by poverty status. So that is very important, one of the lessons learned. Thank you very much. Any question?
थैंक यू सो मच. मेरा ख्याल था, मैं तो सोच रहा था बहुत सारे नंबर हमें बताएंगी. सो आई थिंक द मेन प्रॉब्लम इज दैट वी डू नॉट हैव द नंबर्स. द एक्सटेंट ऑफ इम्पैक्ट ऑफ द फ्लड ऑन द हेल्थ सिस्टम वी डोंट रियली नो. आई हैव बीन वर्किंग ऑन समथिंग फॉर लॉन्ग लाइक सिक्स मंथ्स नाउ एंड हैवंट फाउंड थिंग. आई डिड सम डिटेक्टिव वर्क इन टू डिस्ट्रिक्ट, कंवर शदाद कोट एंड शिकारपुर. पाँच पाँच छः छः सात सात फैसिलिटीज़ अभी तक जो है ना वो फंक्शनल नहीं है, बहुत सारी डैमेज्ड हैं. रिकंस्ट्रक्शन व्हाटएवर रिपेयर के लिए फंड्स एलोकेटेड हैं, लेकिन अभी तक कोई काम नहीं हुआ है. आप जो कह रही हैं कि प्रिपेयर्डनेस, रिस्पॉन्सिवनेस नज़र नहीं आया, ऑनेस्टली स्पीकिंग जो है ना बिल्कुल, मतलब दिस वॉज ऑल्सो, दिस डिज़ास्टर इज़ नॉट कमिंग फॉर द फर्स्ट टाइम. डॉक्टर मेहताब, 1986-7 में भी एक फ्लड आया था ठट्टा में. 40 साल से हम लोग तैयारियां कर रहे हैं, लेकिन और ये तकरीबन मतलब आएगा बढ़ेगा. तो ज़ाहिर मेरा क्वेश्चन बेसिकली है कि डू वी हैव नंबर्स, डू वी नो व्हाट एक्चुअली वाज द इम्पैक्ट इन दोज डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स वाज अफेक्टेड बाय द फ्लड. DHIS चल रहा था, आपको पता होगा. मेरे इंफॉर्मेशन के मुताबिक बहुत सारी डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स में जहाँ फ्लडेड नहीं भी थी, अंडर वाटर नहीं भी थी, फैसिलिटीज़ बंद थी, एक एक महीने के लिए बंद थी. BHUs भी बंद थे, RHC भी बनते हैं, इवन डिस्ट्रिक्ट हॉस्पिटल्स भी बनते हैं. तो ये कहीं से मिल सकते हैं कि उस दौरान में क्या इम्पैक्ट हो?
जी जी बिल्कुल. बल्कि ये नंबर तो मैंने जानबूझ के नहीं डाले, कि आई थॉट कि इट्स एवरीबॉडी इज़ नोन टू इट That's why वो PDMA की वेबसाइट पे भी पढ़े हुए हैं, UN की रिपोर्ट्स में भी पढ़े हुए हैं. इवन टुडे DG साहब को आना था, सो आई सॉ हिज प्रेजेंटेशन एज वेल, जिसमें उन्होंने सारे नंबर डाले हुए, तो मैंने डेलिब्रेटली वो सारे अपनी प्रेजेंटेशन में से नंबर हटा दिए. सो येस, देर आर नंबर अवेलेबल विच सेज, आई मीन आउट ऑफ 1039 हेल्थ फेसिलिटीज विच वर यू नो अंडर वाटर, 799 वर ऑलमोस्ट कोलैप्स्ड. They are non-functional even for next year until it is, you know, reconstructed. So there are DHIS, I mean, figures available as well. There are number of surveys. So even I have currently some of the numbers that 8 million people displaced and 1,700 dead, 5.1 million women of reproductive age affected, 1,915 health facilities damaged total, and 90 districts across Pakistan was affected, and there are a few more figures. So yes, figures are available. Those are available on PDMA website, if you can go and see, and those are available even on UN OCHA website. I have taken these numbers, so number is available. Maybe, I mean, you can ask from DG Saab, he has, you know, number, a busy slide, so.
Service delivery के numbers में जो impact आया ना वो नहीं है. Service delivery में जो impact आया ना flood का, ये तो disaster के numbers. Service delivery में क्या, you know.
जो drops में number होते हैं. अच्छा.
एग्जैक्टली वही मैं कह रही थी कि अभी हम लोग वेट करते हैं डीजी साहब का, उनके पास एग्जैक्टली पूरे सिंध का जहाँ तक मुझे पता है सिंध का तो नंबर है कि सर्विस डिलीवरी में कितना फ़र्क आया है. सो मे बी ही इज़ द राइट पर्सन टू आस्क द क्वेश्चन. थैंक यू वेरी मच डॉक्टर फरीद फॉर क्वेश्चन.
मैम, ये इस साल जो फ्लड आया था 2022 में हमारे इलाकों में भी, ये अगस्त 2022 में, पहले तो गैस्ट्रोएंटेराइटिस हुआ, फिर इसके बाद जो मलेरिया का बहुत पीक थी. जब हमारे यहाँ जो पेशेंट्स आते थे गढ़ीखेड़ों में डिस्ट्रिक्ट जैकोबाद में, तो 100 पेशेंट्स अगर स्क्रीन होकर आते थे 98 पॉजिटिव आते थे. इस वक्त भी 50-60% पॉजिटिव आ रहे हैं मलेरिया के. और हमारे हॉस्पिटल, मेरी हॉस्पिटल में 4.5 फुट पानी खड़ा था हॉस्पिटल में कम अज़ कम 45 डेज. उसके बाद पानी निकाला था, उसके बाद अभी तक जो है ना मलेरिया है. लेकिन जो मेरा ये सवाल है कि जो बिल्डिंग्स हैं या उनका सही पता नहीं, बिल्डिंग्स के जो रेनोवेशन है या बिल्डिंग्स के लिए बारे में जो DG साहब आएंगे उनके बारे में थोड़ी मालूमात हो जाए, या ऐसे मलेरिया के ट्रीटमेंट के लिए कुछ हो जाए, या कितने मलेरिया में पेशेंट्स या गेस्टों में इस फ्लड में जो डेथ्स हुई हैं इनकी मालूमात जो डॉक्टर साहब ने पूछा था हो जाए तो मेरी मेहरबानी होगी.
थैंक यू. सो आपको शायद पता होगा कि गवर्नमेंट ऑफ सिंध ने जो वर्ल्ड बैंक के साथ रिकंस्ट्रक्शन प्रोग्राम पे MOU साइन किया है, इज़ गोइंग टू हाउ मच
Thousand days.
No, that is health. That is related health. I am talking about the reconstruction of damaged health facilities and houses. So, doctor, Sara, kitna amount tha? Main wo bhool gayi hu. Acha. Yeah. But it's huge. It is $1 billion. I don't know, $1 or $2 billion project signed with Department of Health is going to reconstruct the health facilities and houses as well, the damaged houses. So there is a plan. So they are going to do it.
Madam, mera question ye tha ki hamare paas communities ki jab actually badi problem rehti hai. नेबरिंग कंट्री से पहले आती थी ये कम्युनिटीज़, लेकिन अब ये हुआ कि हमारा उनसे तिजारत या जो भी हमारा सिस्टम है अपने बड़ा पड़ोसी ममालिक से, तो अब हम कब तक रिलाई करेंगे दूसरे मुल्कों पे? और वो उसके बाद वो जो चीज़ें आती हैं बड़ी महंगी आती हैं जो आप दूसरी जगह से मंगाते हैं, तो क्या हम अपने पाकिस्तान में ये चीज़ें अवेलेबल नहीं कर सकते?
डॉक्टर रब और हम लोग तो बल्कि ज़्यादा बेहतर बताएंगे. आई मीन इट शुड बी इंडोनेशिया, बहुत सारे ममालिक जो हैं वो कंट्रासेप्टिव अब खुद, इवन IUCDs खुद बना रहे हैं. सो वी आर मूविंग टूवर्ड्स दैट. रिसेंटली एक और प्रोग्रेस हुई है जिसमें DKT पाकिस्तान इज़ गोइंग टू आई मीन असेंबल IUCDs. IUCDs बनाने जा रहे हैं. सो काम तो हो रहा है इस तरफ, लेकिन यू आर राइट, हम जितने पैसे ख़रीदने में लगाते हैं शायद हम जब अपने मुल्क में बनाएं तो वी हैव यू नो नंबर ऑफ कमोडिटीज लाइक इंजेक्टेबल पाकिस्तान में बनते हैं जो कंट्रासेप्टिव हैं, पिल्स यहाँ पे, कंडोम बाहर से मंगवाते हैं. तो ये कुछ चीज़ें हमारी यहाँ पे बनती हैं जो कि डॉक्टर तालिब भी आ गए हैं. सो द गवर्नमेंट डिपार्टमेंट एंड हेल्थ सिस्टम इज़ वर्किंग ऑन इट. There are some partners and players who are, I mean, interested. So maybe Dr. Rab can tell you in his presentation as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you, madam. The immense work outlined by you is no doubt outstanding, and we need more interventions for future as well. I am pleased to acquaint you all with another honorable speaker who have been the provincial head of Sindh World Health Organization, Dr. Sara Salman. Dr. Sara is a medical graduate with a double master degree in public health administration and in public health as well. She carries over 20 years of experience as a public health professional contributing to health system development and program management. She's a recipient of excellence awards over many years by WHO, also a nominee of National Award Tamghai Shajat from Government of Sindh for her services. She has initiated a hospital project under the name of Heal Foundation. Throughout her career, she has served on various scientific and professional committees, author, contributor to many books and chapters subjected to public and reproductive health. She is a mentor and has also been instrumental in mobilizing assistance to the people of Sindh. Let's welcome Dr. Sara on stage to express her views on the occasion.
अस्सलाम वालेकुम एंड वेरी गुड मॉर्निंग. सबसे पहले कॉन्ग्रेचुलेशंस टू ज़ेबिस्ट प्रेसिडेंट, चेयर, को चेयर्स, HODs, डीन, फैकल्टी मेंबर्स एंड ऑल्सो द हार्ड वर्क ऑफ ऑल द फैकल्टी जो वी आर हेयर एंड थैंक यू. माई डियर कुलीग्स, बहुत एस्टीम्ड मेरे सीनियर्स बैठे हैं, डॉक्टर आशिक, आई हैव लर्नड अ लॉट फ्रॉम him, so thank you for being with us. So the topic kafi sari cheezon pe, I mean we are, since we na WHO is working with the Department of Health since many years, but we for the emergency response we started our collaboration from 2019 through when we had a HIV outbreak in Ladkana, then we had COVID and then the floods. So this journey was like, you can see the remarkable changes. I have some like different things as jo my previous esteemed speaker say. So the topic which I am going to like put some light on is like mitigating strategies for disruption of healthcare services, what we have done and what we can do, what's the future of this. So with the start of like all this flood, the first thing which was like in our mind was the rescue, then the restoration of the services as well as the communities, then the rehabilitation, and then the repair and renovation, which is so assalamu alaikum on behalf of like Zebist, I am welcome with Madam Shehnaz Wazili. Thank you, ma'am, for being with us. So these were the things which were in mind and while we were just like establishing our response for Department of Health, and I congratulate and really paying gratitude to each and every health worker and Department of Health for being so responsive. And this time we worked in a very, I mean, just as Dr. Zeb has said that we had a contingency plan, so we worked according to it, although we had some major challenges, but we worked quite well. So the first thing was like the mitigating its vulnerabilities, then the strengthening of health systems, community interventions, access to healthcare and rehabilitation, which was, I'm going to highlight on these things. So there was like a very, from the provincial level to the district level or the community, you can say the community level, because accessibility was one of the major problem at that time. So we worked together, and then, and in future, we are just going to, and I will be sharing you what future strategies government is looking for, along with the partners. So at the policy level, under chairmanship of Minister of Health and Chief Minister, we were working like in Sindh. I particularly more talking about Sindh because I'm like looking after Sindh, but National Ministry was also together working was and supporting Department of Health Sindh and other rehab departments across Sindh. Then the continuity of services, like the provision of essential services, nutrition was one of the major concern. Mental health support, which we are facing like since COVID, but this is one of the major concern for all of us. And then the community awareness for accessibility, and how they are going to respond all these disasters, like at present and in future as well. And then the rehabilitation of services, goods, livestock, everything was damaged at that time. So, the strengthening of health services, we as WHO and the Department of Health or public health specialists work on the famous six building blocks of health services, and it includes each and everything from the service delivery to the health financing. So we worked on these things like to achieve the overall goals, like for the improvement of health services, then the social and determinants and the financial things. One of the major concerns for the in the establishing of healthcare, primary healthcare, especially, and as Dr. Zeb has said that most of the health facilities, like now above 50% of the health facilities were damaged, either partially or fully damaged, and the services was very difficult to, like for the provision of services, and also the accessibility of all the life-saving things and the referral network was damaged as well. So this is as actually the future as well as, and at that time it was a need too. So we try to do, I will be showing some pictures as well, what we did at that time. So, but the thing is like, as WHO and Department of Health Sindh as well as the government of Pakistan is working for this like strengthening of primary healthcare facilities through universal health coverage mechanism, and I hope aap logon ko pata hoga thoda sa. These are the things like it's a holistic approach, and we have there is a shift like it's globally that there is a shift like from it's a person centered approach now. So we are taking individual as like for the holistic approach in the primary healthcare settings. And we all are working for this five C's, like continuity of services and approaches for the primary healthcare services. The ultimate goal for strengthening of primary healthcare services and the provision of services is universal health coverage. We all are working, world is globally, we are talking about universal health coverage, like accessibility, where whatever the requirement is, where is the requirement, and whoever has the requirement with the equity and equality, we are without financial hardship. So this is the basic main goal of universal health coverage. Here I would like to tell you that in Pakistan, we are like, as a pilot, we are the signatories of universal health coverage. We are moving towards it, 20 districts in the pilot, and from Sindh, it's like 8 districts. We are working on universal health coverage. In first wave, it's 2 districts, and then we will be moving towards, like for Sindh, moving towards like the next six, in the second phase we have. And Sindh was the first province across Pakistan who had this universal health coverage benefit package and essential service package endorsed by government of Sindh, and we are in implementation phase now. Sustainable development goals, we all know we are working since, although we have like a long way to go, but still we are trying to achieve some of the indicators, and universal health coverage is one of the main indicator which support WHO is like working for health, well-being and nutrition, zero hunger and all other, like now the environmental change and everything. Access to healthcare services was one of the major challenge at that point, as well as like my seniors has just talked about, like still it's like a change. So for we are, although we are working for the strengthening of primary healthcare services, but access to healthcare services through outreach services, Department of Health is doing, along with the support of partner organizations like WHO and all. So improving access to healthcare, we have already this like provision of outreach services and all. So these are the some glimpses, like we supported like primary healthcare services, pharmacy services, establishment of like labor room in the mobile van and the services like this. Also for the immunization services, the expanded program of immunizations, the EPI program has like across like whoever is in the camp and in the villages of less 5 years of age, Department of Health and WHO supported, we gave them all the this immunization services. Okay. This is also the mobility. We established camps and boards. Dr. Zazeb has already said that, and also the hard to reach services, and across it took me like 1.5 hours to reach for the one camp actually at that moment of time. So strengthening of operational logistics, Dr. Zave has said that it's like a WHO thing. We established hubs. We had like along with other agencies to established 4 hubs initially, and that was 18 August when we had this flood emergency, and on 23rd August it was established 4 hubs: Hyderabad, Thatta, Ladkana and Sakhar. Then from Sakhar, we then moved towards EOC, the operational emergency operational cells in Sakhar and Hyderabad, and still like 2 hubs at Ladkana and Hyderabad, Ladkana and this Thatta. The continuation of essential services, so with the mobile health camps in the communities and at the vulnerable areas as well. Community interventions like need assessments, nutrition, mental health, and also the disease trend, which Dr. Zeb has already mentioned, the DUSE program, now it's called the Integrated Disease Health Service, the Services and Response. And so we all have the numbers who are asking this. And then also the provision of clean water. So we had like developed a lot of like areas where we had wastewater filtration plants and all. Nutrition, the referral networks and pathways, along with the Department of Health and the Nutrition Program, WHO has established. It was initially when we had this flood, we had 26 nutrition stabilization centers for severe acute malnutrition who have complications. Now we have 45, and all are working across Sindh. So I'm just trying to taking about the, so expansion of health services as well as the strengthening of health existing health services. The referral networking, OTP sites are from the UNICEF support, and then WFP is providing the food packages now at the doorstep. Then this is already I have said, these are the nutrition stabilization, this is Sindh actually. Then the mental health component, and WHO is like supporting Department of Health for Sindh. We are establishing telemedicine and GBV response, psychosocial mental health capacity building, as well as like in 15 districts, the vulnerable districts, we are supporting for telemedicine, and civil hospital would be the hub of that. Psychosocial support at the community level at that time, and also we are just like in community awareness, like we're training of lady health workers, and they are just doing things along with the IC material and all. One of the major component and major threat and major concern was the gender-based violence and prevention of sexual abuse, and that was one of the things which was a real concern for all the agencies as well as NGOs and all the communities, and the vulnerability for those who lost their shelters. So that was one of the things which we supported and still we are supporting. Disease surveillance response, Dr. Zeh has already, I think it has detect, response, and then the detection of outbreaks, and then the response and report respond. These are the four things which we are just like detection of any disease, confirmation, report, and respond. Provision of supplies like jis tarah bhi aap baat kar rahe the ki na malaria outbreak tha ya acute water diarrhea cholera was the major concern. Wo cheezein jo thi that was all due to this IDSR we have reported, and we established early emergency disease warning, surveillance and response system. Still it's working, and we are in phase of like ending it and putting the integrated health service in across Sindh. So these were the things. Then, and all the testing kits and all the supplies were there. Cholera, vector-borne disease, these were the like community awareness sessions and the lady health worker sessions. Infrastructure rehabilitation pe bhi baat kar rahe the. So for this, like there is a comprehensive plan of Department of Health Sindh, jo jitni bhi hamari health facilities hai, and UN agencies along with other World Bank partnership and some of the local NGOs as well, they have adopted the facilities under chairmanship of the Department of Health Sindh, and we are going to rebuild it by the next like 150 health facilities in one first phase WHO kar raha hai. 79 already कर चुका है, 19 NSCs बना चुका है, तो इस तरह की चीज़ें हैं जो हो रही हैं, और ये नेक्स्ट ईयर तक ऑल हेल्थ फैसिलिटीज वुड बी रिहैब अलॉन्ग विद द प्रोविजन ऑफ दीज आर द सम थिंग्स लाइक सीमॉक सर्विसेज, EPI सेंटर 66 हम कर चुके हैं, MNE सेल्स हम 31 करने जा रहे हैं, एंड दिस इज ऑल लाइक द NICUs एट दिस इज सिंध. एडवोकेसी एंड कोऑर्डिनेशन, दिस इज वन ऑफ द थिंग वी a lot of missions came, aapko pata hai, UN Secretary General, then MICREA and WHO, you name, and all were there, and it was the worst disaster across the globe. So we are supporting, and we will be like supporting in future as well. Thank you. I guess question koi hai? Ji.
Sir, mera question ye ki hamare paas
पोलियो इज वन ऑफ द लाइक कंसर्न फॉर ऑल लाइक कंट्री, मतलब ग्लोबल है, और पाकिस्तान और अफगानिस्तान जो है दो कंट्रीज अभी भी रह गई हैं. We are in end state in a strategy pe hai, 2023 is the important hamara year hai. All, we have faced some challenges COVID mein, aur phir aapki jo services hain, and then flood mein aapko pata hai disruption of services hui hai, but we are doing, and Sindh to bahut acha kar raha hai. Main Sindh ko represent kar rahi hu, to Sindh ke paas to cases is tarah nahi, although we have one positive environmental sample, but हमारे पास केसेस नहीं है. बट हाँ, पाकिस्तान में वी आर वर्किंग, बिकॉज हमारे पास, आपको पता है, अफगानिस्तान और पाकिस्तान का इन्फ्लक्स एंड आउटफ्लक्स, विच इज़ वन ऑफ द मेजर चैलेंज फॉर अस. एंड हमारे पास अभी तक जितने भी केसेस हैं वो KP की साइड पे हैं, एंड दैट वाज द ओनली रीज़न. सो दिस इज़ द थिंग, वी ऑल आर वर्किंग टुगेदर. आप खुद उसका हिस्सा हैं, सो एंड वी लुक फॉरवर्ड फॉर दिस. सेकेंडली, जो आपने कहा एंटीजन वाइज, हमारे पास काफ़ी वरना बेहतर हुआ है. 29% से नाउ वी आर स्टैंडिंग एट 70% अक्रॉस पाकिस्तान जो हमारे एंटीजन. ऑल द सम ऑफ द एंटीजन ना इनटेक डिफॉल्टर रेट और आपका जो है जीरो डोज इज वन ऑफ द कंसर्न जिस पे काम कर रहे हैं. सिंध गवर्नमेंट जीरो डोज पे बहुत ज़्यादा काम कर रही है. हमारी सर्विसेज काफ़ी ज़्यादा अच्छी, ऑल दो वी हैव फेस्ड मीजल्स आउटब्रेक, आप लोग सुनते चले आ रहे, टाइफाइड है, ये चीज़ें हैं, मगर द प्रॉब्लम विद ऑल लाइक दिस पॉपुलेशन बम जिसकी बात सर मेहताब ने की कि इतने सारी पॉपुलेशन हमारी बढ़ रही है उसके साथ जो हम काम कर रहे हैं आई गेस इट्स रिमार्केबल हमारे हेल्थ केयर प्रोवाइडर्स के साथ मैं खुद होते हैं आई एम रियली सल्यूट टू देम के ना वो जिस तरह काम कर रहे होते हैं थ्रू 24/7 इट्स रियली रिमार्केबल इट्स वेरी गुड बहुत आसान होता है कहना कि ना नहीं हो रहा बट हम सब फील्ड के लोग हैं हम सबको पता है कि कितना काम हो रहा है और अपनी कैपेसिटी से ज़्यादा काम हम कर रहे हैं गवर्नमेंट ऑफ सिंध और डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ हेल्थ बहुत इंडक्शन हुई कोविड में वो लोग अभी तक हमारे साथ काम कर रहे हैं विद ऑल डिफरेंट हेड्स नर्स उसमें आ गए उनको जो है सिस्टम में इनटेक करने की भी कोशिशें हैं और चीज़ें चल रही हैं सो द चैलेंजेस एट द गवर्नमेंट लेवल आर क्वाइट डिफ़िकल्ट और एज आई स्टार्टेड वर्किंग विद गवर्नमेंट देन आई रियलाइज कि कितना मुश्किल काम होता है और कितने चैलेंजेस होते हैं काम करने के लिए बीइंग ऑन द अदर साइड ऑफ द टेबल इट्स वेरी इजी टू से कि ना चीज़ें जो है थैंक यू डन ओके चीफ
मेरा क्वेश्चन ये है कि आई वॉज द पार्ट एक्टिव पार्ट ऑफ द रिटेलिएट कमेटी जो भी हमारा फ्लड था दादू में तो वेन एवर यू सपोर्टेड अलॉट WHO मेरा ये प्योरली पब्लिक हेल्थ का क्वेश्चन है कि आप लोग जब पॉलिसी मेकिंग होती है गवर्नमेंट में क्या आप सवाई WHO के दूसरे NGOs या CSOs को पॉलिसी मेकिंग में क्यों नहीं लिया जाता और डेटा की जो वैलिडिटी है वो बड़ी क्वेश्चन है बोले मुझे कहीं भी नज़र नहीं आई कोई इंटीरियर सिंध में सवाई WHO के कोई भी NGO क्योंकि हमारे सिस्टम में इतनी रिजिलियंस है ही नहीं कि वो टर्म बैक कर सके क्योंकि हमारे फैमिली प्लानिंग पे बात हुई मुझे बात नहीं करनी गई मैं ज़रूर क्वेश्चन करूँगा बिकॉज दिस इज़ द मेन बिल्डिंग ब्लॉक्स क्योंकि फैमिली प्लानिंग में हमारे रूटीन में ही काम नहीं हो रहा तो यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट डिवेस्टेटिंग फ्लड जहाँ पर ना फैमिली प्लानिंग की पी ज़ाहिर हो रही थी ना जी ज़ाहिर हो रही थी तो इतना सिस्टम में हमारी में रिजिलियंस है ही नहीं यू आर टॉकिंग अबाउट दी डिवेस्टेटिंग फ्लड एंड कैलेमिटीज़ तो मैं ये कहूँगा कि जो भी हमारे स्टेक होल्डर्स हैं इंक्लूडिंग WHO ज़रा पोलियो से बाहर निकले और इन चीज़ों को कॉप अप करें क्योंकि WHO का गवर्नमेंट में बहुत सुनी जाती है बिकॉज ऑफ देयर अथेंटिकेशन ऑफ डेटा विच इज़ दी ड्रॉबैक ऑफ अदर NGOs एंड CSOs तो इन पे थोड़ा मुझे फोकस कर लेंगे व्हाट वुड बी द प्लान
अच्छा इसमें एक चीज़ पहले तो बता दें कि कोई भी डिजास्टर होता है ना चाहे वो मैन मेड हो गॉड फॉरबिड या नेचुरल डिजास्टर हो सेकंड डिजास्टर हेल्थ का होता है ठीक है एंड हेल्थ कंटेन्स ऑल द कॉम्पोनेंट पॉपुलेशन डायनामिक्स या फैमिली प्लानिंग उससे अलग नहीं है ठीक है तो सर्विसेज हर जगह पहुँचाना और वहाँ तक लेके जाना वॉज डिफिकल्ट पहले आपकी ना आउटब्रेक रिस्पांस होता है और उसके बाद जो है आपकी एसेंशियल या रूटीन सर्विसेज पे बात की जाती है अगर एक डिवास्टेटेड बंदा होगा और मैं उससे फैमिली प्लानिंग की बात करना शुरू कर दूंगी तो वैसे ही वो भी अडॉप्ट नहीं करेगा तो थिंग्स आर लाइक देयर वर्स थिंग्स बहुत क्लियरली मैं आप सबको एक चीज़ बताऊँ डेटा गवर्नमेंट की कस्टोडियनशिप होती है ठीक है ना WHO की है ना किसी और ऑर्गेनाइजेशन की है पॉलिसीज़ जो हैं वो गवर्नमेंट की अपनी पॉलिसीज़ होती हैं या प्रोविंशियल होती हैं या नेशनल होती हैं ठीक है उसमें हम एज अ सपोर्टर तो हम सपोर्ट कर सकते हैं वी रेज वॉइसेस वी पुट अ लॉट ऑफ थिंग्स एंड बहुत अडॉप्टेबिलिटी है हमारे पाकिस्तान में सिंध में हमारे पास बहुत अच्छे लेजिस्लेशन हैं इम्प्लीमेंटेशन इज़ ऑलवेज अ डिफ़िकल्ट थिंग बट इट्स अ टू वे प्रोसेस एज अ गवर्नमेंट एज अ NGOs और एज अ सपोर्टर्स वी आर ट्राइंग टू इम्प्लीमेंट इट बट आपकी कस्टोडियनशिप गवर्नमेंट या कम्युनिटी लेवल पे मैं और आप जब कम्युनिटी बन जाते हैं तो हमारी अपनी रिजर्वेशंस होती मेरी अलग होंगी फैमिली प्लानिंग में उनकी अलग होंगी आप भी नहीं लेना चाह रहे होंगे ठीक है सो दीज आर द थिंग्स विच वी नीड टू हाईलाइट थिंग्स वी आर डूइंग एडवोकेसीज एंड एडवोकेसी इज़ वन ऑफ द थिंग फॉर WHO जो एमरजेंसीज होती हैं वो ग्लोबली होती हैं पाकिस्तान का जितना भी रिसोर्स है वो एमरजेंसी रिस्पॉन्स हो चाहे वो पोलियो था फिर आपके पास कोविड आया कोई अल्लाह ना करे आइंदा कभी आउटब्रेक्स आए बट लाड़काना आउटब्रेक था या ये डिज़ास्टर्स थे तो इन पे आपके रिसोर्सेज खुद ही खुद मूव कर जाते हैं दीज आर द कंटिजेंसी प्लान्स एंड इट विल गो एज इट इज़ लाइक एक्चुअली थैंक यू
Thank you, Dr. Sara, for sharing the innovative and key strategies for future implication during disasters.
I am extremely delighted to introduce Dr. Talib Lashari, Technical Advisor at CIB Population Welfare Department, Government of Sindh. His areas of expertise are health policy, health sector reforms, health system strengthening, institutional development, population sector reforms, family planning and reproductive health. He has served as Advisor to Health Planning Commission Division, Health Policy Analyst at National Health Policy Unit, and Consultant at Chief Minister Sindh on Social Sector. Dr. Talib Lashari was nominated as representative of Pakistan on Advisory Committee of Commonwealth, Geneva and London. He's a member of Sindh Population Task Force, Sindh FP 2030 Working Group, as well as served as a member of Supreme Court of Pakistan on alarming level of population growth in Pakistan. Played an active role in formulating Council of Common Interest recommendations. Received an award at ICFP held in Thailand on outstanding achievement on family planning in Pakistan. Very recently, under the leadership and guidance of Minister of Health and Population, new initiative of Sindh government on reproductive, maternal, neonatal, child, adolescent health and nutrition, popularly known as 1000 Days Program, Sindh has secured $280 million. He has been leading implementation of CIP Sindh and been instrumental in several reforms in population sector. So I respectfully call upon stage Dr. Talib to highlight the key areas of the climate resilient and health systems.
ये presentation जो है वो दूसरी मैंने भेजी थी, ये तो DG Health की presentation है. मैडम शहनाज वज़ीर अली, मैडम नसरीन, प्रोफेसर महताब करीम, डॉक्टर अजीज़ रब, डॉक्टर ज़ेब, डॉक्टर सारा एंड निदा, डॉक्टर समीरा एंड रेस्ट ऑफ आवर कोलीग्स फ्रॉम प्राइवेट सेक्टर, फ्रॉम पब्लिक सेक्टर डिपार्टमेंट्स एंड फैकल्टी एज वेल एज स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ ज़ैबिस्त. अस्सलामु अलैकुम, गुड मॉर्निंग. Till we get to the presentation, basically the presentation that was that I provided that focuses on climate resilient health system, and title is A Case for Climate Resilient Health System. So I will be talking about, yes, thank you. Thank you. So I'll be talking about climate change and how it has affected Pakistan, particularly Sindh, during the last floods, as well as before that COVID, and I'll be touching upon how we perceive the climate change in our scenario. As you know, climate change refers to a long-term shifts in temperatures and weather patterns. These shifts may be natural, such as through variations in the solar cycle, but since 1800 onward, human activities have been the main driver of climate change, primarily due to burning fossil fuels like coal, oil, and gas. Burning of fossil fuels generate greenhouse gas emissions that act like a blanket which wraps around the world, and that due to that, the sun heat traps within that blanket and temperature on the earth rises. So according to the UN has established a intergovernmental panel on climate change, which is IPCC. According to that panel, global warming reaching to 1.5 centigrade in the near term would cause unavoidable increase in the multiple climate hazards and present multiple risks to the ecosystem and humans. So this is the foundation this IPCC panel is working continuously on global warming. Now it stands at 1.2 per centigrade per annum, but this is going to increase, and if it reaches to 1.5, it will have disaster effects. While it is having already so much disasters at 1.2 centigrade. This is just graph from the that panel that how from 1800 this temperature is rising, and you can see that this temperature has is at faster pace as compared to previous one. So there is a surge as well as a reemergence in infectious diseases, communicable diseases, non-communicable diseases, along with mental illnesses as a result of climate change. But Sindh is severely affected due to drought, dry spells, heavy rains, floods, urban flooding, cyclones, migration, lack of irrigation water, and unsafe water. We have been looking at and assessing the effects of climate change in terms of family planning, reproductive health in Sindh, and data from CIP, IP 2030 initiative suggests that flood has severely affected access to family planning. There was estimated decline of 44% in these services, which can result into more unplanned pregnancies and unsafe abortions. I'll come to the question of family planning, but at the end. The climate change is severely affecting livelihood, women mobility, empowerment to take decisions. There's increased gender-based violence, and incidents of poverty may lead to increase in IMR, MMR, and underage marriages. More than 1,000 health facilities have been destroyed, or fully or partially, in Sindh. And literature suggests that climate-related stresses lead to miscarriage. So this is direct effect on women's health. Miscarriage, low birth weight, malnutrition, infectious, and other SRH diseases. So this is just a presentation of our bifurcating the population by the Pakistan Agriculture Research Council several years back, that what is the proportion of population that is being affected. And if you look at the middle row, severely affected zone, Sindh and Balochistan and some part of the South Punjab lie within the severely affected zones, whereby 65.1 million population is under threat of climate change directly, but it will have more impact in coming years. You can see that in the less affected zones, which are KP and Punjab, severely affected zones, which are Sindh and Balochistan and South Punjab, there's a huge impact, and it's not impact of climate change, but basically these are already affected areas due to several factors. So multi-dimensional poverty there is already at higher pace. So how household fertility transition, dependency ratio, and immunization, all these factors are severely affected in this part of the country. Therefore, we are more vulnerable as compared to other parts of the country. These are list of those health risks that are related to climate change, and we have been seeing during flood emergency, spontaneous abortions, low birth weight, premature delivery, neonatal mortality, dehydration, renal failure, and list is long. So this is how we are facing a growing, alarmingly growing challenge within the health system. During last floods, this is data from NDMA, and till October 2022, The total population was affected in Pakistan, 33 million out of that. In Sindh, it was 11 million, but 7 million were displaced. This just to show you the impact of on family planning services. This is data from the CIP database. So I have already mentioned this is due to COVID, not due to flood, but due to COVID. So this is a work that I have done very recently on climate resilient health system. So we developed a framework, and that framework is presented to the Department of Health to develop a climate resilient health system, because we don't have time, we can't cope with the emergency until and unless we don't have a proper climate resilient health system. So this, you can refer, I have given my presentation to the team. So you can go through that, what are the climate change factors on the left, heat, flood, storm, precipitation, what will be the environmental conditions, how social infrastructure will be affected, and what kind of public health capability and adaptation we need, like warning system, socioeconomic status. You can't address health in isolation or in silos. Health is part of overall development. Overall social determinants of health affect health. So if we look at only facilities, only human resources in health, only BHU and RHCs, we won't be able, because these all are part of overall system, overall society. So we need to look at socioeconomic factors as well. Already, health department is working on vector-borne diseases, communicable disease control, non-communicable diseases, and there's a 1,000 days program. Family health 2030 roadmap is already there, so we can talk during our break or at the end of the presentation. There is a positive trend of increasing financing in health sector. If you look at 2008 and 9 and look at the end 21-22, you can see that there's enormous increase in resources, but are these resources efficiently utilized? Are these resources properly providing this support to the society, to women, children, and other segments of the youth, other segments of the society that needs to be assessed? This is just a snapshot of the budgetary allocations on different programs in the health. So based on this entire assessment and data, we have developed a preliminary, I would not say the work has been completed, not, no, but preliminary, based on preliminary assessment, this is just to see, show that we need a climate resilient health system, and this is now being promoted by WHO, by other international partners like UNFPA. So we have been trying to build, like Dr. Sara mentioned, the six building blocks of health sector. These are leadership and governance, health workforce, health information system, essential medical products, technologies, service delivery, and financing. So based on these six building blocks, we have suggested some interventions against each building block. So for example, for leadership and governance, we need some oversight mechanisms. There's lack of oversight. I mean, mostly we are focusing on processes. Okay, how many staff has come to their facilities, and how many vehicles have moved from Karachi to Ghodki, like that, but we are not looking at the leadership and governance reforms. Health workforce, trained HR, and client-centered approach, this is something we need to build on. Health information system, we have several databases. Now we need integrated dashboards on fingertips, so the leadership and the decision makers should look at those dashboards and take decisions. At the same time, it's very important to have quality of data, accuracy of data. Essential medical products and technologies, likewise service delivery. In service delivery, we suggest emergency preparedness, climate-informed health programs, addressing environmental determinants of health. Until and unless we look at beyond health sector, things won't improve. It's always a multidisciplinary action. We call it healthy public policies. We need to move towards healthy public policies. And the financing, it's very important. My last slide is regarding recommendations based on that assessment. So first of all, we need to assess the vulnerabilities, where and what are the pockets. Like in 1,000 days, we have assessed around 400 government dispensaries lying in desert, in delta, in hilly areas, in arid zone, in peri-urban areas. We forget about peri-urban areas and slums. Now, more than rural areas, peri-urban and slums have become a biggest challenge for health and population. So we need to focus on that. We have already focused, like we have the Challenge Initiative program for slums. We have 1,000 days program, and so many other programs as well. But we need to focus on outcome and impact. We are all the time focusing on process indicators, input. And at the maximum, we look at outputs. We are not looking at outcomes and impact. That is very, very important to look at. Framework on climate resilient health system. We have developed a preliminary framework. District plans are very important because you can't develop a policy at provincial level or national level and then forget about, but we need to go up to the last mile, up to the communities. Inform, sensitize, educate, and train health personnel and communities. Our health providers should come out of their JD's model, and they should focus on human-centric health system, whereby they should be sensitized on climate resilient, on women empowerment, on linkages with other sectors, linkages between health and population. These are important areas where we need to sensitize our HR. Prioritize climate-related risks and improve resilience in the water, sanitation, and hygiene sectors. So these are those areas where if we intervene into those areas, these will have implications for primary health care. So thank you so much. So there are a few questions, I believe. Dr. Fareed Midar has raised his hand.
Sir, I have a question.
Dr. Fareed has... Dr. Fareed, are you? No? Oh. Just a minute. Sir.
Yeah, I was actually referring to, I was impressed by the presentation. Individual level pe jo climate change ka effect ho raha hai na.
So
individual level, at the woman level. Basically, we are looking at a 1.5 Celsius increase in the next 5 years. Pakistan will be affected. Pakistan is one of the top 10 countries which are actually affected by increase in temperature, right? There are several studies which actually indicate that, for example, a 5 degree Celsius rise in the week before the delivery increases the risk for stillbirths and premature births, okay, as well as early neonatal deaths. And there is actually a meta-analysis done in a 5% increase of preterm birth per 1 degree Celsius increase in temperature. ये जो सिचुएशन है बड़ी सीरियस है क्योंकि हमारे यहाँ जो स्पेशली जो गांव में और लो इनकम अर्बन एरियाज़ में जहाँ ना बिजली है ना कोई तो अगर वो खातून की जो डिलीवरी से पहले 15 to 20 डेज़ में अगर टेम्परेचर इंक्रीज़ होता है तो एकदम से शूट अप होती हैं, और ये हमने पाकिस्तान में नोट किया है DHS सर्वेस के अंदर कि स्टिल बर्थ रेट और हमारा जो नियोनेटल मोर्टेलिटी रेट है एज वेल एज पेरिनेटल मोर्टेलिटी रेट इज़ नॉट कमिंग डाउन, इज वेरी रिजिलिएंट. सो दिस इज़ वन थिंग टू रिमेंबर. द अदर थिंग इज़ अबाउट, आई वॉज वरीड अबाउट द फ्यूचर, लाइक दिस ईयर प्रॉबेबली दिस इज़ फोरकास्टेड कि शायद फ्लड ना आए, लेकिन नेक्स्ट ईयर का कोई नहीं कह सकता उसे नेक्स्ट ईयर का, बिकॉज ऑफ द पॉपुलेशन एक्सप्लोजन, यू नो. बिकॉज अगर ये फ्लड ऐसे 40 साल पहले मुझे याद है जैसे ठट्टा में आता था, उतना ज़्यादा डेवेस्टेटिंग नहीं होता था, लेकिन अब चूँकि पॉपुलेशन इतनी ज़्यादा है, तो स्पेशली वो पॉपुलेशन जिसको मैं कहता हूँ अनरेगुलेटेड, ना वो अर्बन है ना रूरल है, वो बीच में कहीं है, और उसकी जो है ना वो कोई मतलब सर्विसेज की भी एक्सेसिबिलिटी नहीं है, तो एक मतलब मुझे नज़र नहीं आ रहा है कम्प्रिहेंसिव प्रोग्राम जो इस चीज़ को एड्रेस करे कि नेक्स्ट फ्लड में हमने क्या करना है, उसमें अगर कोई आपके पास.
वेरी पर्टिनेंट क्वेश्चन. मेरा ख्याल है कि हमने बिल्कुल आप सही कह रहे हैं कि जो वार्मिंग का जो परसेंटेज बढ़ता जा रहा है उसमें डेफिनेटली प्री मैच्योर बर्थ्स और स्टिल बर्थ्स और उसी की वजह से न्यूनेटल प्रीनेटल मोर्टेलिटी में इजाफा हो रहा है और कंट्रोल भी नहीं हो पा रहा. मेरे ख्याल आपने इसको सही कोरिलेट किया है, क्योंकि अगर हम देखें तो सिंध के अंदर कराची के अलावा अगर नॉर्थ एरियाज़ में जाएं तो वहाँ पे 50 डिग्री सेंटीग्रेड होता है, 45-50 दैट इज़ नॉर्मल इन इन पीक ऑफ द समर. तो उसमें बिल्कुल मेरा ख्याल है कि ये चीज़ हमें असेस भी करनी चाहिए कि इसका कितना उन पर इम्पेक्ट है. एविडेंस तो मौजूद है जो आपने सही कहा है. जो आपने ये बात की कि अब हमारी तैयारी क्या होनी चाहिए, हमने ये थोड़ी सी एफर्ट तो की है क्लाइमेट रेजिलिएंट हेल्थ सिस्टम, लेकिन इस पर पॉलिसी एडवोकेसी की ज़रूरत है, क्योंकि शायद इस पर अभी इतना नहीं समझा जा रहा है कि क्लाइमेट रेजिलिएंट हेल्थ सिस्टम होना चाहिए. काम तो बहुत हो रहा है, काम तो काफ़ी हो रहा है, लेकिन कम्प्रिहेंसिव अंदाज में काम करने की ज़रूरत होगी. और ये कि उसको फिर लिंक करना पड़ेगा डिफरेंट सेक्टर्स के साथ, क्योंकि अगर रोड नेटवर्क डिसरप्ट होता है तो आपकी फैसिलिटी बेशक 5-स्टार हो, लेकिन आप वहाँ तक पहुँच नहीं सकते तो करेंगे क्या. तो सारे जो डिफरेंट सेक्टर्स हैं उनकी लिंकेजेस बनानी पड़ेंगी. और आपकी ये बात बिल्कुल सही है, मैंने भी थोड़ा सा इसका जिक्र किया है कि पाकिस्तान लाइज एट द हार्ट ऑफ क्लाइमेट चेंज, जो कि ग्लोबली भी बताया गया है. तो मेरा ख्याल है कि ये आई एग्री, उस पर हमने ये काम शुरू किया है, लेकिन हम चाहेंगे कि ज़ैबिस्त भी इसमें अपना रोल प्ले करे. ज़ैबिस्त का जो पब्लिक हेल्थ डिपार्टमेंट बना है उसकी तो मुझे बहुत खुशी हो रही है कि एक फुल फ्लेज है. डॉक्टर फरीद आप भी उस साथ हैं, डॉक्टर समीरा अंडर द लीडरशिप ऑफ मिनिस्टर साहिबा एंड मैडम शहनाज, आई कांग्रेचुलेट. तो उस पर मेरे ख्याल है कि इस तरह की चीज़ों पे कि स्टूडेंट्स के जो रिसर्च प्रपोजल्स हैं या जो डिजर्टेशंस हैं उनको आप लिंक करवाएं रेजिलिएंट क्लाइमेट रेजिलिएंट हेल्थ सिस्टम के साथ, और फ्लड एंड अदर डिज़ास्टर्स लाइक कोविड एंड अदर इमर्जिंग डिजीज़ कम्युनिकेबल एज वेल नॉन कम्युनिकेबल, इन एरियाज़ पे स्टूडेंट्स एंड यंग फैकल्टी को रिसर्च के एरियाज़ में आना चाहिए. उसमें ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस बहुत हैं, दे कैन फंड यू, दे कैन सपोर्ट यू एज इंटर्न्स, दे कैन सपोर्ट यू एज पार्ट ऑफ देयर एक्टिविटीज सो दैट यू कैन बिल्ड योर कैपेसिटीज एंड डिवेलप योर प्रपोजल्स, योर डिजर्टेशंस, योर कॉन्सेप्ट पेपर्स जो कि टर्म पेपर्स भी होते हैं. तो बहुत ज़्यादा सिंध में कंड्यूसिव इन्वायरमेंट है कि यहाँ पे तकरीबन कोई 28 से 30 डिफरेंट INGOs और NGOs काम कर रहे हैं, जिनको CIP खुद डायरेक्टली हम उनके साथ काम कर रहे हैं. तो देर इज़ लॉट ऑफ अपॉर्चुनिटीज़. अब आपने प्लीज़ आप इंट्रोडक्शन और फिर.
सर माय नेम इज़ डॉक्टर शिराज वाजा. अच्छा सर, ये जो आपने क्लाइमेट चेंज पे आज प्रेजेंटेशन दिया है, मेरे ख्याल से ये वक्त की ज़रूरत भी है, क्योंकि आजकल जो डेवलपिंग कंट्रीज सबसे ज़्यादा सफर कर रहे हैं, या आप ऐसा कहें कि GDP का जो ज़्यादातर
आर्ट है वो खामखा ऐसी चीज़ों पे जा रहा है जो हमारी कहीं ना कहीं इन्वायरमेंटल मिसमैनेजमेंट या इन्वायरमेंटल डिस्टर्बेंस की वजह से हो रहा है। तो ये जो कार्बन फुटप्रिंट आजकल बढ़ रहा है जिसकी वजह से इन्वायरमेंटल डिग्रेडेशन और ये क्लाइमेट चेंज हो रहा है, तो एक तो इसका डायरेक्टली इम्पेक्ट पड़ रहा है एक तो ओवरऑल इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर पर, उसके अलावा जो हमारे हेल्थ फैसिलिटीज़ हैं रूरल एरियाज में, आप देखें तो अभी तक हमारे डिस्ट्रिक्ट में ऐसी हेल्थ फैसिलिटीज़ हैं यू बिलीव मी वो हट बेस्ड चल रहे हैं, एक हट में बने हुए। तो वो आप समझें कि क्लाइमेट का थोड़ा भी अगर शॉक आता है तो वो तो सस्टेन नहीं कर पाते। दूसरा उसमें यह है कि ये जो क्लाइमेट चेंज आ रहा है डायरेक्टली या इनडायरेक्टली हेल्थ को तो इम्पेक्ट कर रहा है। तो जो इंक्रीजिंग डिफॉरेस्टेशन या डेजर्टिफिकेशन हो रहा है आजकल हमारे पास, तो उसको ख़त्म करने के लिए उसको रिड्यूस करने के लिए क्या गवर्नमेंट की तरफ से कोई ऐसी अग्रेवेटिंग ऐसी कोई फोर्सफुल पॉलिसी होनी चाहिए कि हर मंथ हर सिक्स मंथ्स हर क्वार्टरली ऐसी मूवमेंट्स चलाई जाएँ। मैंने खुद अपनी लाइफ में मोर देन 50 ट्रीज़ प्लांट किए हैं, क्योंकि क्लाइमेट चेंज तो एक इंडिविजुअल बंदे की जो है ना वो एक्टिविटी से भी तो चेंज हो रहा है ना, तो वी नीड मास अवेयरनेस ओवरऑल एंड विद द सपोर्ट ऑफ गवर्नमेंट इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर एस्टेब्लिशमेंट। थैंक यू।
मेरा ख्याल है कि ये इस बात से कोई कोई मतलब डिसएग्री नहीं कर सकता कि ये कितना इम्पोर्टेंट है कि और अदर देन हेल्थ और एरियाज में हम इंटरवीन करें। वो इंटरवेंशन हेल्थ डिपार्टमेंट नहीं कर सकता, बल्कि वो इंटरवेंशन बाकी डिपार्टमेंट्स पब्लिक हेल्दी पब्लिक पॉलिसीज़ के थ्रू कर सकते हैं, गवर्नमेंट कर सकती है। और उसके लिए हमने कुछ अर्सा पहले रिक्वेस्ट की थी और सजेस्ट भी किया था कि सिंध में हेल्थ सेक्टर कमेटी बना दी जाए तमाम उन डिपार्टमेंट्स की जो डिपार्टमेंट एक दूसरे को रिलेट करते हैं। और मैं एक चीज़ आपने सही कही और मैं उसमें इजाफ़ा करूँगा कि देर आर सो मैनी कॉस्ट इफेक्टिव इंटरवेंशंस जो कि हम कर सकते हैं, लेकिन उसमें कितना कम्युनिटीज़ इन्वॉल्व हैं, सोशल रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटी कितनी है। हम जब बाहर जाते हैं मुल्कों में आप देखें कि वहाँ पे कोई ये नहीं है कि गवर्नमेंट का कोई नुमाइंदा खड़ा है और वो सबको डिसिप्लिन सिखा रहा है। पीपल आर ऑलरेडी डिसिप्लिनड। एक दरख्त है तो उसकी हिफाजत करनी है, दरख्त नहीं है तो दरख्त लगाने हैं। वो कोई गवर्नमेंट का नुमाइंदा आके नहीं लगाएगा, बल्कि कम्युनिटीज़ को चाहिए कि वो रेजिलियंस की तरफ जाएं, सोशल रिस्पॉन्सिबिलिटीज़ हो, सोशल अकाउंटेबिलिटी हो, कि लोग न सिर्फ खुद एक्टिव हो के हिस्सा लें बल्कि लोग गवर्नमेंट की जो फैसिलिटीज़ हैं या एक्टिविटीज़ हैं या इंटरवेंशन हैं उनको भी अकाउंटेबल करें, उनसे उनके बारे में भी पता करें जी आप कहाँ और कैसे अपना दे रहे हैं सर्विसेज। अभी जो 1000 डेज का प्रोग्राम है वो जैसे डॉक्टर फरीद ने कहा कि रूरल और सलम के दरमियान कुछ आबादी है जो इसका पता ही नहीं है, वो वाकई एक इम्पॉर्टेंट एरिया है, लेकिन इसी पे एक जो प्रोग्राम 1000 डेज का आया है वो इसी पे फोकस कर रहा है कि वो जो बिल्कुल अंडर सर्व्ड एंड अनसर्व्ड एरियाज़ हैं तमाम इन डेजर्ट डेल्टा ऐसे इलाकों में, उनको हमने फोकस किया है कि वहाँ की GDs को कम्युनिटी हेल्थ सिस्टम डेवलप करके लिंक किया जाए डिस्ट्रिक्ट हेल्थ सिस्टम के साथ। मगर एक या दो मज़ीद आप जो हमारी आप अपना इंट्रोडक्शन भी कराएं और आवाज़ आ जाएगी मेरे ख्याल माइक अगर दे दें क्योंकि जेंडर बैलेंस होना चाहिए एक हमारी
एक्सक्यूज मी सर आई हैव अ क्वेश्चन
एक मिनट सिर्फ उनका आप वैसे ही बात कर लें समझ में आ जाएगा।
जैसे कि फ्लड में
जी जी जी
असलाम सर असलाम स्पिरिट साहब सर
वेलकम जी साहब
वेलकम सर सर आई हैव टू आस्क वन क्वेश्चन रिगार्डिंग द हाईली डिसएडवांटेज एरियाज ऑफ द सिंध प्रोविंस स्पेशली इन द फॉर द डिस्ट्रिक्ट उमरकोट एंड वेयर द फ्लड अफेक्टेड द सम एरियाज इन हाफ ऑफ द सिटीज and where some WASH activities are there. And I want to ask the how we implement as regarding your presentation. I want to notice one point. First, we make the district plan regarding the any activities or any strategies. And sir, I want to ask how we implement the WASH activities in government sector for to prevent the maternal morbidities and neonatal mortalities. In this regard, I want to ask some.
Exactly. I think the remote areas are still a challenge, and so many interventions are being implemented by the government of SEN. But the importance would be that our community-based workers, they need to be focused on WASH activities, on family planning activities, on other primary healthcare facilities. Also, we need to engage family physicians or GPs who are sitting in the far-flung areas. And also we need to perhaps engage even traditional birth attendants in these areas by giving them some sort of training, brief training. So I think some of the interventions are already focusing on these areas. लेकिन हमें ज़रूरत इस बात की है कि हम इन चीज़ों को फॉर्मलाइज करें और उसका एक रिस्पॉन्स 1000 डेज प्रोग्राम है जहाँ पे कम्युनिटीज़ के अंदर बैठे हुए वर्कर्स को मोबिलाइज करके और वो ऐसे एरियाज हैं जहाँ पे LHW नहीं है तो कम्युनिटी वर्कर्स वहाँ पे इनक्रेज किए जा रहे हैं को काम करने के लिए एंड उमरकोट इज़ पार्ट ऑफ दैट एज वेल आप अगर आखिर में ये चाह रही हैं
जी जी प्लीज थैंक यू वेरी मच माय नेम इज डॉक्टर सर्वत एंड आई एम एन असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर पब्लिक हेल्थ ज़ेविस्ट आई वुड लाइक टू आस्क द रोल ऑफ वीमेंस एम्पावरमेंट इन द मिटिगेशन ऑफ द करेंट रिस्क एंड इन फ्यूचर रिस्क एनालिसिस बिकॉज एग्जिस्टिंग लिटरेचर सजेस्टेड that the most vulnerable population that is affected by the extreme weather events and climate change are women and children. And it affects the general health as well as reproductive health and mental health of the women. So I want to know, do you suggest any role of women's empowerment in making an alignment with the stakeholders and governmental efforts to mitigate the current risk for the most vulnerable population and for the future risk analysis? Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Women empowerment is a great idea, and that is 50% of our population. And most of the time, we don't focus what we need to do about the women empowerment. I mean, we had started listening sessions, What Women Want program a few years back. 1000 Days program is also focusing on women empowerment. Also, the vision of FP2030 is that we want to transform social and gender norms by 2030, so that empowerment of the women is at the forefront. तो ये चीज़ें हैं जिन पर हमें काम करना होगा लेकिन ये मैं आपको इसको यहाँ पर मैं एंड करूँगा लेकिन मैं आपको ये बताना चाह रहा हूँ कि इट्स ए साइंस वी नीड टू फोकस ऑन इम्पैक्ट एंड आउटकम ओरिएंटेड पॉलिसीज not process and input oriented policies. We need to focus on impact aayega kahan se, implement hogi kaise. Policy banane se pehle ye soche wo implement kaise hogi. Humne CIP banaya tha, usko successfully humne implement kiya tha aur uska impact ye aaya ki 4 percentage point CPR bada rural areas mein jahan pe CIP ka focus tha. Slum pe nahi tha aur urban pe nahi tha jiski wajah se wahan pe ye issue aaya. Lekin mera khayal hai ki कोई भी पॉलिसी बनाने से पहले हमने फोकस करना होगा इम्पैक्ट और आउटकम पे प्रोसेस इनपुट आउटपुट्स दीज आर ऑल वेरी इम्पॉर्टेंट बट वेदर द पॉलिसी विल लीड टू आउटकम एंड इम्पैक्ट और नॉट दैट इज द क्वेश्चन नंबर वन एट वेरी सॉरी इसरार यू वांट टू It's a brain child of Minister Sahib. Just, I think it's a very lengthy reply, but मैं आपको एक जुमले में कह दूंगा कि ये कम्युनिटी जो अनसर्व्ड और अंडरसर्व्ड हैं उनके अंदर कम्युनिटी हेल्थ सिस्टम हम बना रहे हैं, डिपार्टमेंट बनाएगा और वो कम्युनिटी हेल्थ सिस्टम लिंक किया जाएगा डिस्ट्रिक्ट हेल्थ सिस्टम के साथ एंड ओवरऑल हेल्थ सिस्टम के साथ। बाकी कुछ मैंने डिटेल दे दिए हैं और ये मैं आपके साथ डिस्कस भी कर सकता हूँ ड्यूरिंग द ब्रेक। आप थैंक यू, थैंक यू।
Thank you, sir, for enlightening with your treasure of knowledge and vast experience in the field. So now I would like to request Madam President to present Shields to our honorable guest. We are profusely thankful for your time and patience. Please, Madam Shehnaz, and I would also request Madam Nasreen to also accompany Madam Shehnaz. Our Dean, Dr. Kashif Ali, please accompany for group picture as well. Dr. Zeb Dahar. Dr. Samira, please. Dr. Kashif Ali. Dr. Samira, aa jaye. Dr. Sara Salman, thank you again for your presentation and time. Dr. Talib Bashari, thank you, sir, for your time and presentation. Thank you, madam. Thank you, Madam Shehnaz and Madam Nasreen. Now it's time for a tea break. Okay, okay, ma'am, please.
Give me the program, please. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. I know that everybody is very now keen to take a break for tea, and you've had a lot of food for thought since the morning. I just wanted to take a minute to thank our morning speakers here, Dr. Zeb Dahar and Dr. Sara Salman, Dr. Talib Rashadi, Dr. Mehtab Kareem. And thank you very much for the prospective speakers who will be coming up after the tea break. I think that the sessions have been extremely informative, very substantive. A lot of very useful, relevant information has been presented. And I hope that our faculty members and our students both will take away from these presentations ideas that will be further explored in the classes and in your assignments, and also maybe in the research papers that you produce, in the dissertations that you do, in the final year projects that you undertake. I also hope that with our esteemed guests who are here from different organizations and also representing the Government of Pakistan, Department of Health, Department of Family Planning, we'll also keep in mind that the universities have a great deal of potential, both in our faculty as well as in our students, to undertake activities for you, particularly if you want to have surveys conducted, you want to have data collated, you want to have data sets compiled, you want data analysis done, you want short analytical papers done, you want some policy briefs prepared, you need some material prepared for communication or for further work or for further investigation. This can be on the structures in the health system, the family planning system. This can be on the systems, and what Dr. Taleb Lashari was talking about, that we often look at, you know, how is the budget going into the system and what are the inputs, but we don't look at impact, we don't look at outcome, we don't look at intersectorality. There are lots and lots of issues. I think that this morning sessions with the various speakers that we had, who are the top of the line speakers in their fields, will have given each one of you a great deal of substantive issue information on which you can begin to think where you want to focus your particular professional area of interest. Because everybody who's in the public health sector should begin also to focus in certain areas of public health so that you can then begin to specialize in those areas. That's very, very important for Pakistan. This is a very critical area. And I'm very pleased that Zavist has finally got a public health department. It has been here for a couple of years now. I want to thank Dr. Samira Rizvi, who's the head of the department, Dr. Nida Shoaib, who's the program manager, Dr. Bilal, Dr. Dean Kashif Ali, who's sitting there, and who actually gives overall guidance and provides a great deal of mentorship for the entire Department of Public Health. Our chancellor takes a great deal of interest. I personally take a great deal of interest, so does Vice President Academics. But the real energy has to come from you. The real intellectual, professional energy, the searching, the thought-provoking questions that you might have in mind, I hope that the faculty and each faculty member will engage in small focus group discussions after these presentations so that you can, and our these presentations will be available with us, and I want to thank the speakers for that. The climate resilience adaptation set of issues itself is so complex that here is a whole area for you to study, and for many, many decades, this issue of global warming is going to affect the health and the lives of people. So I just wanted to leave these thoughts with you, that when you come to a symposium or a seminar, it's not just to listen and go away and sort of say it was very nice, but it is to see what is the work you want to do afterwards. Which strand, which issue, which complex set of factors you want to investigate further on what has been presented. And I hope that each student will think of that. It's a wonderful opportunity. I want to thank everybody again, and please join us for a cup of tea.
I request my reputable guest and faculty to proceed towards the meeting room for refreshments. Students, you are requested to remain seated. The symposium will commence after a short break.